Hello everyone. We are at Kunstmuseum Basel Gegenwart. In this episode of Archive of Emotions, I'm again with someone that I don't know. We just met right now, so it gives me the chance, the occasion to ask much more direct questions. Mm-hmm. Also, I told you already that a couple of minutes ago. Thank you so much for allowing me for this. As usual, we didn't prepare something because it's about emotions, it's about truth telling, and I believe when you don't prepare, it's much more easier to share the truths. So today, my guest is Michael Birchall. Thank you, Michael, for coming here, being my guest. You are new in Switzerland since October. You are the new curator of Migros Museum Zurich. So far, how are you? How is it going here in Switzerland?
Thank you for the introduction. That's really nice, and it's great to be here and to see your show and to visit this institution again. I recently moved to Zurich, and it's been a really good start, I would say, despite the pandemic. And I've had a really good introduction to Zurich and the art scene there. And but of course, I'm looking forward to get to know more artists and institutions across Switzerland in the next year when it's allowed, really. It's great to be here and to have this new challenge in my life as well.
Mm-hmm. Right before moving to Zurich, you were living in UK, and UK for me is one of these mother countries for post-truth. Do you have anything to say about the post-truth in the UK, and then maybe we can open this in the global level? How yeah. was this maybe Brexit situation? Let's start with it, and maybe. Yeah,
it's still painful, Brexit. It really hurts a lot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting for me because I didn't work in the UK as a professional at all mm-hmm. until I started working at Tate Liverpool in 2016, and that was I think that was the year of mm-hmm. the Brexit vote. So I was living in Germany, in the European Union, and you know, I'm working in this country. And there's all this like kind of anti-European sentiment, really. And I guess I always had an issue with the UK sort of growing up and as a young adult, that I always felt there were problems within British society. One of them being British people never really came to terms with their colonial past. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this this legacy and this huge cultural intervention and societal, political, economic in Britain is so evident and present every day. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I was living in Liverpool, I was working there, which is actually my hometown. I was born there, and then coming back to your hometown where you left as a teenager is very weird as well. Mm-hmm. But you know, the legacies of the colonial past in Liverpool are so prevalent because Liverpool was such a central part of, it was one of the largest ports of the empire, mm-hmm. and you can see traces on architecture, the street names are named after slave traders, it's omnipresent. Yeah. And this is a problem, and I think it was particularly interesting recently in the last years, or the last year rather, with this kind of the Black Lives Matter movement, which came into the UK discourse, which is actually quite different from the mm-hmm. US. And of course, I'm not speaking as a person of color, just as a person of British nationality. In Bristol, there was the toppling of mm-hmm. the statue of one of the most prevalent slave traders in that part of the country. And, you know, this was a real momentous moment that people living in this context just decided to just, you know, bring this statue down. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of hoping that this would spread throughout the UK. And there was even a conversation I listened to, I think on the radio, where someone was saying, we need a slavery museum. And I think somebody called and yeah. said, well, there is one. It's in Liverpool. It already exists.
Yeah.
So this kind of, yeah, and then I am digressing a bit, but I think the Brexit position really comes from this problematic of being an island,
mm-hmm.
and also
huge history,
having a huge history, but not really coming to terms with it, and mm-hmm. not really acknowledging certain positions and cultural influences and trauma,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, the UK is a difficult place. It's mm-hmm. it's. I think also people who live there, it's a very hard society. There's massive division between rich and poor, and mm-hmm. this is getting wider every year. And many people have to move away from places like London because they just can't sustain a life there.
Mm-hmm.
And but at the same time, you know, if I talk to my friends who are, say, from Germany or Sweden or Switzerland or whatever, they always remind me of the wonderful cultural production that comes from the UK,
mm-hmm.
from music, visual arts, mm-hmm. theatre, comedy, film. And that is really interesting, and it is really influential. But, you know, I was talking to a friend, I think last year, and we were talking about, she's an artist, and we were talking about her art practice in the 1990s, and she reminded me that she was living in Stockholm back then, and she remembers in the early 90s going to London in the sort of middle of the 90s, and I think going to Frieze and reading Frieze magazine, and how she was introduced to this like super hyped contemporary art context, which was not present anywhere else at the time in Europe. I mean, I know that some Germans will disagree and say they had Cologne and whatever, and of course there was a discourse there, but the London scene then was super inspiring, and she was just talking about this expanse of cultural production, and
mm-hmm.
that London is still carrying this kind of mm-hmm. Legacy as well. So, you know, I think I'll always go to the UK and I'll always visit London, but I think it's a troubled place to live, and I also don't want to sound too gloomy about it either, but I just think there's a lot that Britain needs to come to terms with. And actually, I think one of the things that is necessary now, sort of post-Brexit, mm-hmm. because this is, it's not finished, but this is like the next step, is that British society has to talk about what's next, and where does Britain want to go.
Do they speak? Are there platforms to speak?
Yeah, no, I guess platforms these days is social media, but then I think that's also living in a bubble.
And filters.
And then you have political platforms, but at the same time in the United Kingdom you have the kingdoms of the United Kingdom want to become more independent. So this idea of like Scottish independence is really looming,
mm-hmm.
and actually the recent pandemic has amplified that conversation, because it's shown what different nations can do in the UK. And you know, but this is highly problematic. Like, what kind of fractured societies do we want to live in, where small island nations want to separate off and have more control?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, this idea of control and bringing back your national interest is for me, I don't really understand it, because I consider myself to be like a European citizen, and mm-hmm. to not have this kind of divisionism. And I think it's also my generation that we were born at a time when this identity, this the sort of cultural good and mm-hmm. and the societal good of mm-hmm. unionism was promoted. And you know, I also remember as a young adult being at university, and all of the European money that was ploughed into the UK, and
mm-hmm.
literally areas were improved, lives were improved. You know, my master's degree was paid for by the European Union.
Yeah.
You know, so this is like, so yeah, it's a complicated time.
Yeah. I think, I mean, it's important, this generation topic. I would like to talk about decolonization as a curator and its importance and its role, your role. But before, I would like to say a little bit about these generations. I mean, now people who are in the power positions, they are the generations of children of the post-war people. They didn't grow up with this digital technology. They have a different way of seeing this, seeing life. But also, we are now under the control of technology, and we are completely globalized. And sometimes I have this observation that people who run us, they don't understand the young generations who are completely global in their minds. They know that whatever they do, it's affecting somewhere else in the world, where on the other side of the globe. And also, that's also shows this lack of communication between these people who are running and these people who are demonstrating in the streets. That and these people, they get depressed or disappointed because they don't see the change, because people who are in the power position, they are much more like their parents' generation. They want to hold it. They just want to grow capitalistically, make much more money, etc., instead of taking care of this oneness, togetherness of the globe. But let's, you said you used the word colonization, and also we are talking a lot in the art decolonization. And do you think, as a curator, I mean, of course you have responsibilities, but how do you see, as a curator, the responsibility of decolonization in your life, maybe, or generally in the curatorial field? Do you have something to say?
I comment on the first part first?
Sure,
as well?
Sure.
Because I think that's really, really interesting, and I think this globalized world that you talk about, where younger generations are like interconnected with one another and can share or have common discourses that move across the different areas, is, you know, it's, we've never had this point before in our lives where we can access this information and be part of different narratives in different ways. And I think the makers of the internet and social media never imagined that this impact would happen. And obviously, if you're speaking about the post-truth era, then this is intrinsically linked to this. But I think it's, I think there is a generational difference. And I think for an older generation, it's difficult for them to understand this level of connectivity and discourse, actually, which moves across different places and is indiscriminate of class, race, and gender, which under the previous sort of hierarchies were the old gatekeepers, if you like, of discourse, knowledge, but this is incredible, and I think this younger generation and how they view the world without any kind of discrimination, xenophobia, etc., and their own identity, like, you know, we're in this swathe of like
deconstructive.
Absolutely. Yeah. And like identity is so prevalent. And also, like, for my generation as an LGBT person, it's like, you know, I wish I was like much younger now, because the dialogue and the discourse is just fascinating. And you know, I think
and maybe much more direct also.
It's much more direct, and it's much more enacted in daily life. And I think for some people this is also problematic or confusing because they don't understand the terminology or the references. You know, I was talking to a colleague yesterday, and we were talking about TikTok, and she was telling me that, you know, we were talking about an exhibition that we're working on, and she said, you know, the movement in the exhibition that the artist is talking about, it's just like TikTok. And I'd never even thought the two interlink. But this is really fascinating, and I think the more that we immerse ourselves in this and we engage, then we become more open-minded. And I think those that dismiss it or are afraid or confused, then it's going to be tough for them, you know. And you know, I also think about it historically in terms of specific moments that sort of provide a countercultural moment. So, if also you mentioned the post-war generation. They, well, not all of them, but there was a countercultural moment that came after the war, which was a resistance to previous, let's say, power structures, colonialism. But this was propelled at the same time through individualism. So you had the kind of hippie movements, etc. But this was again very small. You had this 1968 student riots, young people again. But in a way, they also retreated back to the sort of middle class idealism mm-hmm. that their parents had had. Mm-hmm. But they were told, or they were given this prospect of, you as an individual have more of a position and a right in the world than you've had previously. So individualism and greed has sort of propelled us to this point.
Yes.
Yeah. And now we're at this moment actually where we this process of capital accumulation mm-hmm. has sort of reached its peak. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the previous crisis in 2008, governments tried to support their banking infrastructure, support the networks, keep it going, pump more money into it. But this just doesn't work anymore. And even this kind of, if you're my age, or if you have to come to terms with the fact that you won't own any property, mm-hmm. which for some people, not everybody, was the ideal lifestyle choice and was considered normal. So all of these structures are like dismantling. And so I don't know if we're at another countercultural turn, maybe we are. Mm-hmm. And I think this recent pandemic, which a lot of people assert and say it's very short, not much will happen. Lots of things will happen because of this. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, the previous Spanish flu pandemic had a huge impact on how people live, on architecture, how much light you should have in your living space, how much ventilation you should have. Mm-hmm. So I'm open-minded about all of this. Mm-hmm. But your other question was about decolonizing structures and my position as a curator. Yeah, I think, you know, curators are, in a way, that terrible neoliberal term, producers of knowledge, mm-hmm. in a way. And we work with artists or collections or collectives or ideas, design, whatever, film. And we transform this into a public platform. Mm-hmm. So whatever we're connected to in our work has to connect to those discourses outside of the walls of the museum. Mm-hmm. And again, but the history of museums themselves is also intrinsically linked to colonial legacy. The idea to collect, mm-hmm. to amass objects, mm-hmm. is a colonial act. Mm-hmm. It's to bring objects from elsewhere. It's to, again, that problematic term, exoticize,
yeah.
things from other cultures,
yeah.
and present them into, you know, in the 18th century we had cabinets of curiosities, mm-hmm. in museums. I mean, curiosities full of random stuff that had no kind of classification, narrative. And then, of course, with visual arts and connoisseurship, etc., you have this expert of the curator who is, mm-hmm. was once, or a keeper of art, a person who has knowledge in a specific area, but this connection to collecting is still problematic,
yeah.
And many modern contemporary art museums in the last, I would say, 15 years, they've moved towards models of global art collecting. But, you know, this goes hand in hand with how contemporary art has traversed the world, mm-hmm. if you will, through art fairs, biennials, mm-hmm. Kunsthallers. You know, the white cube, mm-hmm. is omnipresent in various global, mm-hmm. discourses. So having an artist that you acquire for your collection or exhibit even from, I don't know, Japan, and bringing it into any other collection, mm-hmm. is you're still sampling that context. But we're kind of, it relates back to your previous point about this kind of new age of identity. We're still sampling objects from elsewhere, mm-hmm. but bringing them into this neutralized space of the white, mm-hmm. cube. But I think the my own personal perception on decolonizing institutions is that it's an ongoing process, and it's not a topic that we can fix quite easily. And you know, I used to work for an institution that had a large collection of objects from, I don't know, the 1600s to now. it's massive. And you know, in that context, decolonizing the institution requires all kinds of dismantling of systems, hierarchies, powers. And I also see from colleagues internationally that, you know, there's a bit of there's a bit of fear around this, because it takes away your position as the curator and the keeper of knowledge. And this is problematic. But it's I don't know, you know, I work with contemporary artists. I'm not adverse to this, and also for me it's an ongoing learning process. In the you know, in the last couple of years I've read a great deal around decolonizing collections, around trans-historical curating, but working with artists and also members of the community and other people from outside, this enables you to shift and change your position. But ultimately, we have to look what's going on outside the museum and make sure that this is present. This is also a shift, though, in identity politics, rather, that audiences or publics that attend museums want to see a reflection of themselves. Yeah. But I think they always did. I think we talk about this in contemporary museums as something new, but it's not. I mean, if you look at, you know, the writer John Ruskin, who was writing in Britain in the 19th century about, you know, he wrote about museum visitors at the National Gallery. And I remember there was, when the National Gallery opened in London in the middle of the 19th century, there was a policy that the National Gallery could be visited by the working class. And they could come into the museum and bring picnics and eat their lunch and look at the paintings. And he
when
thought...
When was it?
I'm sorry?
When was it?
In the 19th century. But I can't... Sorry, I can't say the exact date. But he was horrified that these working class people were eating their lunch inside the museum and not really appreciating the art. But of course there's massive problems here with class, privilege, 19th century Victorian society in Britain, and power levels. But still, there was, you know, back then the museum thought that this was a good idea. So, you know, and this legacy is still around. You know, we still want to do outreach and inreach, and we still want to bring in communities that don't perhaps visit museums. There are of course problems with that, again, with hierarchies, privilege, knowledges. But the ideas have always been around. It's not a new concept.
Again, when it comes to the generations, I mean, our generations, we are bridging generations, because we were born in this analog, like before digital movement, and then we also tasted, it started with our generation, this technology and everything. And I have the feeling when we will arrive to the power positions, you know, we have a choice to make. Are we gonna keep the legacy of what's the previous generation, how they deal with this capitalist growing, or do we want to be this bridging generation who will make the maybe concrete radical changes to adapt to the vision of the upcoming generations, younger generations, that as I underlined before, who has a much more global perspective and connection, and who feels this maybe earthling responsibility, social responsibility in everything. And for example, Caroline Emke, a German philosopher, in her book, When I Say Yes, she's talking about the hierarchy of pain. And she's saying that in the hierarchy of pain, the number one everywhere in the world is the economy. And the governments, everything, every institution is always about the economy. And there is no more time for the second degree problem. Second degree is the social problems. And just because of this economical thing, there is no time, no energy to spend for the social problems. But also, at the same time, I will a little bit turn the topic, but I'm sick of seeing people in the power position who says that, oh, my generation couldn't do anything, it's your generation's job right now to change it. And this, we couldn't do that, it's your job right now. This is something that I'm so pissed off. Mm. Do you have something to say about this, as being a bridging generation person, about this, we couldn't do it, it's your turn now to change it atmosphere?
I'll start with a personal reflection. So my grandmother, who passed away a few years ago, who was in her 80s, mm-hmm. she once told me that about climate change. Mm-hmm. She said they warned us about this in the 1970s and they did nothing about it. Mm-hmm. So she was already aware that this was a concern in the mm-hmm. 70s, as most of the world was informed, mm-hmm. And she was angry that this hadn't been resolved. Mm-hmm. Other people do have these problems as well, but But I'm curious how you see our generation. What is our accountability? What changes can we make?
I try to talk about a little bit in the book. When I talk about these vitrine situations and the institutions, I mean, we are dominate. I mean, we live in a patriarchal society, which is actually all about dominance and violence through this dominance. And now we see a lot of changes in the vitrines of institutions. We're giving much more space to women, trying to much more space for LGBTQ+ community or POC community, to minorities, differently abled people, communities. Mm. You know, in the vitrines, a lot of institutions, they try to make this change. But at the same time, the structure behind of this vitrine, how the system it is turned in the institutional levels, they are still the same higher hierarchy, patriarchy, the same way of finding money, you know what I mean? And yeah. I believe there is zero problem with this vitrine, because it should be. It should be, because we need it anyhow. We need this thinking anyhow, even if there is no direct change in the system. Mm. But I believe, personally, I seriously believe, because the hierarchy of pain, number one is always economy, maybe we should try to find a new ways of finding the money. For example, in the art institutions, I believe with art, it is much more easier, comparing to any other field, to find a new ways of developing currencies or new way of fundraising. So, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, your questions are massive. It's like,
I know,
it's
sorry.
Exactly. It's like, you know, I need to take notes and I need to write an essay back. You know, it's like, where the hell do I start with this? You know, I think, firstly, I agree with you with the, like, economic being the sort of pinnacle of our society. But, you know, all of this, like, emerged in, you know, with the Industrial Revolution, etc. And we've, like, tried to maintain control through democracy, and the economy has been sort of in tandem with this. But I'm not sure, though, now. I think, in a way, you were saying that individuals or power hierarchies and institutions are controlling society. I think, yes, to some degree, but I also think the corporate model, mm-hmm. I think corporations have such a big part to play in the world that we live within. And, you know, we all, not all of us, but a lot of us are sort of subservient to telecommunication companies, I don't know, Apple, Amazon, whatever. And, you know, we relinquish some of our personal information, we allow it to go into big data, and then we allow the corporate model to sort of drive our consumption patterns, tell us what we need to do, how we're feeling. This is algorithms. This mm-hmm. is like the machine is having this implicit part in our life, but then this but then there's this resistance from individualism to kind of rile against this. And I do see, I also understand what you mean about like the power structures, and you're using museums as an example, but I would say that it would extend to other areas as well. But you know, the sort of museums, libraries, universities, the sort of like knowledge core of society is there to enact societal change, inspire, and also it's about learning, isn't it? It's not those those structures are about learning. And you know, we know from like revolutions, the first people to go are the teachers, the artists, the cultural producers, because they're the ones that like ask the questions. But you know, I'm trying to unpick your massive question. but you're talking about museums working with presenting, showing artists, persons of color, LGBTQI, disability activists, etc. I think museums are more open to this discourse, but I don't see it as being so restrictive in terms of like governed by hierarchies. I always think that museums are, let's say, successful or open-minded by the people who work there. It's the educators, it's the curators, it's the mediators, it's the people who greet you when you come in, it's the people doing the accounting, you know, it's the technicians, it's the whole system, it's the people who work there who actually say and have a personal opinion and comment on specific elements inside the museum, and they're the ones that actually do it. I think you know, the sort of director level or that the hierarchies in the museums do exist, but this really depends on the scale of the institution and how it sees itself. But I know that in the last couple of years, you know, there's been some appointments at some museums which have been really talked about because of the diversity of the candidate, and I think this is fantastic, and we have to be more diverse. But there is a kind of blockage in certain institutions which are governed by old hierarchies. And I think in Britain, in lots of contexts, this is still very prevalent in across the society, but I think it's the individual, it's people who can really enact change, who can really dismantle those structures.
And can you a little bit, I mean, I know it's very short term that you are in Zurich, but do you see any big differences between the system that you were in the UK and now what you are in here?
Yeah, I would say in the UK, the conversation about public participation, widening access, diversity is much more prevalent in society, not just in institutions, but in society. So this is this, and this isn't just within the cultural sector. So I did a leadership training a few years ago, which was organized by Stonewall, an LGBT leadership training. And most of the interesting people and the context that was being presented were from very corporate environments. So the corporate responsibility and accountability to be more, let's say, diverse and inclusive is also being driven by them in a way. And I think museums in Switzerland and other organizations are moving towards this model, but there's a lot of learning that needs to go on, and there's a lot of conversations that need to occur. And I'm curious to see how this will transpire in the next couple of years, because I think this is coming to the Swiss context and to the kind of continental Europe, really. I think the important thing to remember, though, with any kind of discourse around diversity inclusion, is to think about like local specificities. So if we're talking about, for example, Black Lives Matter, it's difficult for us to transplant an ideas and concepts from a North American discourse, even into the UK.
Yeah.
Like, I'm working with an artist right now on an exhibition which opens next year, and we're working on the catalogue, and the writers that we need to talk about their work in this production need to have an understanding of a UK context, for want of a better word, and this discourse in the United States is quite different, I think we need to learn from each other. And, you know, the other thing which I find really interesting is, you know, in the UK context, we're really, or rather, it's really important to mention your pronouns, for example, mm-hmm. in your work mm-hmm. context. And, you know, in the German language, at least, this is still an issue that hasn't been fully discussed or resolved, mm-hmm. and especially around non-binary members of our community. Mm-hmm. So I'm still trying to kind of understand this, but I feel like we're on a journey to adapt in a way.
Yeah. And I would like to also talk a little bit of this, the cultural dominances, in the sense of UK is part of it, but of course number one is always USA. In the mass media, generally mass media, we know every detail about what's happening in the USA. And then the world runner countries like UK or the European Union, France, Germany. And then if there is some time left, or there is an extremely sad story in a forgotten country, it's also put at the end of this chronology of hierarchy of media. And as someone from UK, do you feel responsible in the sense of, as a British person, I don't know, I ask this question to my American friends, because most of them, they don't even notice that how much we are bombarded with the US informations, but at the same time, they are talking about the decolonization, or I don't know, but because we are all the time bombarded with their information, and we try to adapt what's happening in the diversities, the changes, transformation to our culture, which is also, as you said, it's not that healthy at all, because percentages are completely different, the cultures are completely different, the languages are completely, vocabularies, everything is completely different. So it brings a tiny little bit this chaos, media dominancy, and knowing everything about them, but also their citizens, they have maybe lack of information about the other countries or other things that they are dominating somehow. You know, I see a little bit of maybe I'm tired of, on the other hand, this Western domination all the time, and also the ignorance of the people from this country to how their culture are affecting the other countries. For example, I make a mess over here at the moment, sorry about that, but for example, I have a friend from Turkey, she's 50-something years old, and she heard the word POC 2 years ago, and 2 years, because she learned it because somebody told her, hey, how was life of as a POC person in Switzerland? And she said, I never thought that I was POC or something. You know, she never had this skin color palette to have a check or something. She was like, oh, okay, I didn't know that I was half black. Or, you know, she didn't have this because nobody told her or treat her differently. But because of this Western identity stuff, she's been since 2 years, oh my God, I'm POC, apparently. And the vision of life is switched, has been switched. You know what I mean?
So you're saying that, like, there's some kind of external conversations, or let's say identity questions that are like infiltrating other societies, but those people aren't perhaps equipped to
or the cultures are they don't
the permit. Cultures are just different.
And it's still functioning in the same hierarchical system, same patriarchal system.
Well, it's still othering, isn't it? That's the thing, you know, we're still othering people. And you know, Sarah Ahmed in her book Strange Encounters talks about this very, very well, and other writers talk about like othering, and it's still based on hierarchy and privilege and access, really. What enables you to access certain privileges in the world which we live within, and I think it takes a long time to dismantle and understand those structures. And I think, you know, as long as we remain open-minded and we have conversations and we do, I don't know, training courses and we read books, then this helps us to understand the other perspectives. And you know, I think everybody that's working in museums should do very important like unconscious bias training and training on diversity and inclusion. There are other things they should do as well, but this just, it's a real understanding of how you see visitors, how you see yourself in the museum. And, you know, again, like lots of corporate environments do the same thing. But your earlier point about the sort of dominance of United States and its media, I don't really see it as being so dominant, actually, in the way you describe it. I think, you know, like if I think of the news that I receive through my own social media channels, through friends, which obviously is like filtered, and obviously it's also, you could say, a bit of a bubble, but people are reading and they're aware of other things that are going on in different places. So I don't think it's particularly as dominant as perhaps it used to be in the way that it appears in our news. And I think, but there's still a sort of, I guess, dominance of wealthy nations being more prevalent in international news, particularly if it's like around, you know, natural disasters, or you know, like what was the recent thing that happened in Texas? They had some snow, and they lost all their power and. You know, that was like big news. But I remember getting a little bit annoyed recently about the protest that happened in Washington at the Parliament, or what's it called? And I was talking to a friend about it, and he was like, it's terrible. And I said, yeah, but like people have stormed parliaments for like centuries. Like this isn't anything new. And, you know, there's been so many other like revolutions that have happened where people have taken it upon themselves to go to their parliament and protest and seize parliament. And I'm not saying that's right or wrong, but why should people be surprised that this could happen in the United States? You know, it's like this, certain people have idealism around like how democracy should function and that you shouldn't be allowed to do this, or there's a serious problem if it does. But if you're in the era of post-truth, when you have presidents like Donald Trump, then why can't people go and storm a parliament? It's
already expected.
Yeah, exactly. So again, I guess this friend was coming from a perspective of old hierarchies and certain levels of like appropriateness. And you know, people have always been resistant to certain powers, and you know, this is how people were able to vote or were able to marry their partner or walk down the street on at the certain side or take any bus they want to. I mean, you know, we've always had these models of resistance.
We are highly politicized we live in a highly politicized period of time, and I am convinced that institutions also they have to have a political position. For example, giving visibility, diversity to the minorities, etc. It's already something very political, but it's not always assumed. Should it be maybe something official? Like institutions might say, "Hey, we stand for that," you know, and showing it directly instead of just doing it silently, etc. I think institutions has to also say, like, I stand for this. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. I'm on the board of an arts centre in the UK, and their building is part of the legacy of slavery. Mm-hmm. So for many, many years, they've had programs that have talked about this, and they've also had, like, because of the recent Black Lives Matter movement, they reevaluated their kind of statements on this, their position. But it's become intrinsic in the program. It's like everything that they do, they're talking about this very openly. I think some institutions should take this very seriously, and I think policy is good, but again, it has to be enacted by the people who work there. They have to embody this.
And of course,
if you have, you know, you need people inside museums that come from different backgrounds, that have different lived experiences, that have different understandings of culture, society. This makes the workplace more interesting, but it also allows us to reflect in a different way. And of course, we don't know everything. Mm-hmm. You know, I always feel like when I'm working with an artist on an exhibition or a project, I'm learning with them. And if it's a discourse that I'm not familiar with, then I want to be aware of this. And I'm the first one to hold up my hand and say, you know, I don't understand the terminology, or I'm not comfortable to talk about this. And I remember when I was really, really young, one of my first jobs was in Canada, and I moved there totally naive to Indigenous culture and discourse, and I met many, many people that would give me books to read and talk to me. And this was triggered because in Canada, whenever you give a public presentation, you have to thank and mention the unceded territories of the Indigenous population that the museum is built on. Mm-hmm. And I felt really uncomfortable saying this because this isn't my land and I'm not familiar with this context. So I had to read so much. I had to talk to people and you know, this whole perspective is quite different there. And you know, in institutions can say that they do lots of things again, but they have to have ways of enacting. And also, museums are always institutions are always afraid of failure. And I think it's also one of the problems with, like, the cancel culture that we're in at the moment. Yeah. Is that doesn't allow things for you to try things out and to say, you know what, we got this wrong. Can we try something else, or can we learn from this experience? And I think this also, or rather, people should be a little bit more forgiving to institutions. I know lots of people disagree with me for saying that, but I think there has to be some mutual understanding, you know, because as people, we, our opinions, our practice, the way that we interact, it develops. We're not fully formed individuals with fixed ideas. Well, not. I'm not, but perhaps other people are, I don't know.
We have very short time left. Do you have any question?
Yeah, I wondered what your current perspective is on the post-truth era and the global pandemic and how people are interpreting this.
I really believed when the pandemic happened at the beginning, I called a couple of friends that I am regularly calling to talk about politics, what's happening, etc. And we said, like, we have to come together, we have to maybe write an open letter and to meet with the cultural institutions in Basel, because here in Switzerland we have direct democracy, we can contact the cultural department or to the canton and make an initiative, because you just have to collect signatures, right? And we wanted to, we came together to write this letter for the against domestic violence, climate change, and also sans-papier people, people who doesn't have any permit, anything, and also people who work in the culture, who or self-employee who lost their jobs. Like, let's talk about this, what we can do together. And I really believe the pandemic situation, we could really turn it to make the process faster for these important topics. But I was quite disappointed, to be honest. We couldn't even make the second step after the connecting to institutions, because these institutions, they are, of course, they were all saying, hey, let's wait. Let's wait what's gonna happen. And after all, nobody did anything. And you know, I think we have lack of courage in this post-truth area, because we don't know the information, if how much is it true, to who to rely on, etc. And because of these corporations that you are saying, everybody's responsible of 100 other things, and nobody wants to really take the weight on their shoulder by themselves, and everybody is waiting the confirmation or this obedience from the other people, and I think this is a very big problem. And also, when in this area, I believe the best way to deal with the post-truth is telling the truth. And sharing this truth, I don't believe it can happen with rhetorics and monologues. That what we see generally in the media, in every time. I mean, people, perfect rhetoric people, they are in front of a camera, putting these perfect sentences one after another, telling you that everything is all right. I mean, I don't buy this anymore. I think the best way to deal with the post-truth is like a dialogue and showing vulnerability and questioning. As you said, like, the museums has to be allowed. We shouldn't have this cancel culture. We should be allowed to share our doubts, because we are not perfect. We should be able to, we can only learn if we ask stupid questions.
Exactly. Yeah.
Stupid questions. I mean, that's how children learns. You know, and we were all children, and we are still children. Why to kill this beautiful child inside of me, in the name of being this perfect person to not hurt anything? I mean, if I don't hurt you, I will hurt somebody else at the same time, in the name of not hurting you. I don't know. I think it's not something that we can. I mean, it didn't happen in one day, and it cannot disappear in one day, this post-truth thing. I think we should just learn how to live with it. I mean, I read an article about that, which was saying that we should all, everybody in the world, have to be responsible of media reading. Everybody has to learn and get educated at the schools how to read the media, being able to make a selection about that. But also, I mean, why giving a responsibility to every individual on earth that if you want to live on this earth, first you have to know how to deal with the information? You know, since when we have to have a guidebooks to live on earth? I mean, life should be free.
but I remember at school, though, having an introduction to newspapers, and I remember learning the left wing, the center, and the right wing newspapers. I remember, like, learning the difference.
Yeah.
It was like introduced to us, you know, which one will you read, you know?
But I don't know, can you teach to a primary school child, these are the rules of manipulation, and if you notice this eye gesture of this person, or if this mimic, after this mimic, it means this, I don't know.
I'm sure we'll have, like, algorithms that we'll just put on, and it will give us, like, a rating, like, energy for, like, TVs or whatever.
Yeah. I did, maybe the one thing that I find dangerous in this whole thing, not not even individual manipulations or things like that. It's algorithms, actually, because algorithms, they don't have empathy. They just there to sell you the product, and they don't care.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, last question. Do you have any projection, wish, or something from your life, or the society, or something as a change?
I think people should care about each other a bit more, and we should be a bit more, we should have more empathy, really. Mm-hmm. I think that's one thing that would be nice, if we could just be a bit more caring. I think because of the pandemic, this has started to happen again in the right way. And I think the idea of community and society has moved into a very local discourse. I mean, we were sold the idea of globalization, but then you have that terrible term of the glocal, you know, people buying things locally, putting up signs in their local neighborhood. I think this is slowly returning, but it needs to be more forgiving and not a sort of like controlling mechanism of like telling people, no, you can't plant your plants or vegetables there. They have to go there. Like we have to kind of,
you know, harmony.
A bit of harmony. And you know, I can be like a romantic if I think about writers like Margaret Mead or, you know, people like Jane Jacobs and her ideas on how we should live in society in urban places and how she really fought for like people should be able to live in an urban context and have a good life. Mm-hmm. And I think this is kind of slowly returning in some places, but then there's always exceptions to the rule.
I agree with you. I mean, I wish the same for everybody, but I would maybe add the cherry on the top of it, a little bit of courage to the people. I think we have to be a little bit more courageous. Michael, thank you so much for coming. It's nice to meet you.
Thank you too.
And thank you so much for watching us, and see you next week. Bye. Je vois la vie en rose.